What kind of music did your parents play when you were little?
A lot of music. A mix between a lot of rock and songwriter type music or pop music, and then a lot of stuff was like classical music or compositional music or slightly experimental contemporary type music, like instrumental records like Penguin Cafe Orchestra music or Tubular Bells by Mike Oldfield or Vivaldi, Mozart, Beethoven, like Tchaikovsky kind of stuff too, just mixed in with a lot of Joni Mitchell, Paul Simon, and Beatles, and Carole King, and Barbara Streisand.
Type of music influence you in the way you express yourself in your music right now?
Yeah, of course. I feel like there's no way to avoid that. I feel like anything, whenever the earliest things it seems like you're exposed to are the ones that stick the most.
I read in the bio as well that you were about 12 when you picked up the guitar for the first mm-hmm. time.
Yeah, I was like almost 13.
Okay. And mm-hmm. Did you realize then that you wanted to be a musician for as long as you could?
Yeah, totally. I got really into it. It was one of the first things that I felt really great about. Yeah.
And it felt just like, okay, this is what I want to do. This feels good. Mm-hmm. Me and the guitar just...
Yeah, something you know, something you love so much that you don't even think about, you know, spending a lot of time doing it.
And 12 years seems a little bit late, but is it? Or do you feel
it
like...
It depends, yeah. I mean, I met a lot of people that started way earlier. Like, my keyboard player has played, he plays, his first instrument was drums, and he started playing when he was like 4. But then he, you know, then, and I didn't formally play music until around that age, like 12, 13. But then, you know, then, for example, he started playing drums at 4, and then he started playing keyboards when he was like 20 or something. But because he played drums, transferred over to playing keyboards or something. So it depends forever. It's different for everybody, for every sort of thing, I feel like.
And I read as well that you listened to Wes Montgomery when you were a kid.
Yeah, I love Wes Montgomery. A friend of mine showed him to me, a family friend, and I got really, really, really inspired and just totally changed everything for me when I got into this album called Smokin' at the Half Note. It's a live album with Wynton Kelly on piano. And yeah, it's an amazing record.
And do you still listen a lot to him?
To Wes? Sometimes, yeah, totally. His music got me on like a channel into a lot of other types of music and getting into, I was like first jazz music that I really got into. But yeah, I mean, yeah, I love going back and listening to that record and others of his playing. The cool thing about Wes Montgomery is that he was like a self-taught player. He actually started really late. They said he started playing when he was like 30 or something like that, or at least in his 20s when he started playing guitar, supposedly. But he was self-taught, but he was a jazz player, and he pushed his ear really hard to pick things out. And as a young guitarist, that was really, really cool to, listening to his riffs, there's something that you can easily pick out. That's a little bit, you know, it's easier than picking out somebody like, you know, maybe somebody really complex like Pat Metheny when you're first starting out or something, or like, or Pat Martino or some of the crazy bebop type of players who it's hard to, you know, it's hard to pick up immediately everything that they're playing. Some of the stuff everyone does is like simple and complicated, but yeah, like Wes is a very like complex, but in a simple way somehow. It's
so
like,
you studied him and you played his music as well when you were just starting with the guitar?
I kind of just listened to it a lot and I riffed around with it. Sometimes I try to solo along or try to pick out little things, you know, which I couldn't nail nearly everything he's doing at all. But you know, if you pick out a couple little things here and there, it's just like that's kind of what starts you out playing music, is picking out melodies, I feel like, you know, from something you like.
And you had your own studio in your own house, and mm-hmm. at what age? Can you recall?
Well, when I first started recording, it wasn't quite a studio, but I made it a studio of just a computer microphone and a PC, and I downloaded this program called Audacity that you can still download for free, and it's just like a PC or Mac program, and it has built-in effects and different things, and that's how I started recording the first time. I was like 14, 15, started experimenting with that program.
And do you still listen to the recordings now when
sometimes
you're new?
Occasionally.
Can you see the growing in your musical career from where you are now looking at where you were about then?
Yeah.
Do you see a big difference?
Oh yeah, in some ways. It just, yeah, it depends. Some ways, like, I feel like, you know, it's like trying to just always trace to what's the most pure experience. But a lot of like, definitely, I mean, I knew I could, you know, couldn't play as well then on guitar technically or know as much about it. But it was a cool, and there's a lot of experimentation, a lot of accidental things I did in those stages that ended up being like really beautiful, and that taught me a lot about how I wanted to continue to explore music. You know, like I would record overdubs without headphones when I first started out, so they would start feeding back on each other and creating this like overtones and stuff. And then maybe partway through I'd realize, oh, I should plug in headphones while I keep doing overdubs. So some of the overdubs would have this kind of weird feedback thing going on and a ringing sound that made the recordings interesting. And then other stuff would be clean, and I learned about, you know, contrast through that, which as I've learned more and more about fidelity and musicianship.
So are you also interested in the technical part of the engineering?
Yeah, I love it. I think it's like really exciting, a new instrument or something that we have, you know, it's really exciting to me.
And I read that the song What's In It For was recorded for just for fun.
Yeah, totally.
Sort of. But when did you realize then, okay, I'm working
on a record?
Yeah.
Well, that was through, I recorded two songs. First one I did was this song called Summer Come, and then I think we started doing, then we did that song What's In It For. It was with a friend who had a proper studio in his house in LA when I was like 17, almost 18 when we recorded that. And then a record label guy that he knew from Sub Pop in Seattle, who used to live in LA, contacted him and asked him what he'd been listening to, and he mentioned me and said that, you know, like, was asking him about kind of unsigned or unknownish, whatever, people that were playing, and he said, oh, you know, check out Avi Buffalo stuff. And so the guy was checking out my MySpace page with my home demos on it for a while, back and forth, checking in periodically. And when he saw that I put up the first kind of like high fidelity song with this guy who was his old friend, he called his friend and who was working with me and said, oh, what are you working on? And, you know, you got a broken tape machine or something, maybe we can help you. You know, it kind of implied something along the lines of, oh, we could be interested in putting out this record. And we didn't even know we were making a record, you know, we were just recording and experimenting. And
when came that point that you realized, okay, and from now on I wanted to make a record? And
basically from then it was like, okay, well, I mean, you know, I guess Sub Pop, you know, wants to sign me or something, maybe, so I'm gonna make more songs and make a record, you know, and kept communication, and they kind of kept, you know, a weird sort of healthy distance and, you know, vantage point to see what we were working on, and kept sending him stuff, and then a record was done, and in the meantime kind of started to negotiate, you know, contracts and a record deal and stuff like that. So that was my like senior year of high school, and then the following fall I signed with them, and then the spring after that was when the record came out.
Yeah, it dropped in 2010.
Mm-hmm.
And immediately a tour followed, and you were just
before, immediately. Yeah. We were touring before it came out, and then after.
How was that period for you? Because you were just from playing in your house or at a friend's house to touring.
We'd played a lot of shows when I developed into a full electric band after, you know, before that. And we'd been playing a lot in LA area, Long Beach and LA, and just kind of being like always available. So we were experienced in playing shows, but not in traveling, touring. So we got it on the road, and it was, you know, quite hectic. You know, it was amazing fun and also super overwhelming and wild and, you know, unexpected. So, you know, just kind of did it for a bit, and yeah, went for it, you know, went, experienced different time zones, weather changes and countries and places, you know, which was really exciting.
Do you really know do you really know where you are in a country? Like, is it that chaotic, or do you really know that, okay, I'm now in Belgium or I'm
Yeah, you know where you are, but I just mean like the aspect of traveling and being on tour with people that, you know, you didn't ever imagine what even touring really kind of was, and then you know, you're stuck in a van together for hours and hours and hours and hours and lifetimes a day. So, you know, a lot of things like that, just kind of finding the balance, as opposed to also being able to like play a show and go back to your house and do whatever, you know.
And do you miss home then when you're such a long time touring?
It depends. I mean, right now, this trip I've been on has just been fucking awesome. I've been really, really loving like every day of it. And I don't want to really go home right now because like it's beautiful and interesting. And yeah, sometimes you miss home. It depends on how the trip's going, how you're doing. But yeah, there's a lot of times then when I was just like, yeah, I want to totally just get out of here, just go back home, write music and practice, you know, because you don't get enough time to really practice.
Do you also write music when you're on the road?
Yeah.
Pops up, you know?
Totally. I always try to. And it's fun. You get to mess with other instruments when you're on the road, too, because you can't always just bust out a guitar in the van. There's not enough room. So then it becomes a computer or a drum machine or, you know, or drawing and writing instead or something like that, you know, for fun. But there's always, like, room for creativity on the road.
The internet describes your music as indie rock, sort of. But how would you describe it yourself?
I would say it's like song based. I kind of like, I started out, my first band that I had was like a rock, like a kind of a jammy rock group, like a lot of wah pedal and stuff like that. And I had heard a lot of different kinds of music at that point. But then I wanted to make something that was like quieter. And so that was kind of like the first starting point was like, just kind of like hearing what it sounded like to sing really quietly and play really quietly. And more of a focus on lyrics, so yeah, it's like I'd say it's like song music, you know. If you're looking for like a for things with, you know, kind of like chord progressions and emotional lyrical content, that's kind of what I'm going for, I guess.